Welcome, everyone, to Southeast Stadium, and we've got a good one for you tonight here on Paragon Cable. I'm Jim Brockman along with Charlie Wells, and we've got Southeast and Riverview for you tonight. Riverview, of course, ranked number one in Class 5A in the state of Florida. Southeast ranked number two in Class 4A. Both teams are undefeated, Charlie, and we also want to welcome all the good folks along the Sunshine Network here tonight. And Charlie, actually a dream matchup for us here tonight. And talk a little bit about those running backs. Of course, Southeast has Freddie Smith. Riverview has Sean Bain. How does that matchup work tonight?
Sean Bain, Jim, he leads Manatee and Sarasota County rushers, and he's one of the best we've ever seen. He's only a sophomore. He's something that we can look forward to for the next few years around here. Riverview really has a quality back there. Then on the other hand, we have Freddie Smith that's running for Southeast, and he's number two only to Sean Bain. So I think you're going to see those guys carrying the ball an awful lot based on what we've seen out of these two teams before. Two tremendous teams, both of them extremely good on offense. I think we may see a high-scoring game here tonight, and I believe that it's going to be one that everybody will enjoy statewide and, of course, here in Manatee County.
It ought to be a good one. Don't go away. We'll have more interviews for you and football coming up in just a few moments. Okay. It's my pleasure now to introduce John Sprague, head football coach at Sarasota Riverview, coach of the number one team in Class 5A here in the state of Florida. And John, a big game tonight, of course. Maybe your biggest test since beating Manatee. Is this the toughest team, the biggest challenge since that Manatee game?
Yeah, first of all, we're number one ranked, not number one.
Okay, well.
Yeah, they are. They're extremely talented. Southeast year in and year out has as good a talent as anybody in the state. Paul does a good job. They're very well organized, very well coached. This will be a great test, and thing as good as there's life after it. You know, we go on, and I got two more undefeated right in a row. I got Clearwater Countryside and Clearwater, which is both ranked, so it doesn't get any easier from here, but we're looking forward to this game. It's a good rivalry.
Okay. A lot to you. We were talking a little bit earlier, and you're talking about Sean Bain getting a lot of press, the great sophomore running back. But you made an interesting comment that never won a game with just one kid. Obviously, Sean Bain is a vital part of your offense, but talk a little bit about what else makes that offense go.
Well, I'd be very truthful. Probably our mainstay is our offensive line this year. We've got a very experienced fullback in Darrington Abner, Division I player. Bernard Marshall does a good job. But, you know, it's like, you know, and all our kids realize that, you know, one of the credentials of a great running back is always good blocking. Our offensive line has graded out 90% or better each week. And, you know, if that doesn't happen, nobody's going to run anywhere. So without them, we're not very good. So probably our biggest reason offensive success is because of the offensive line.
What concerns you most about this undefeated Southeast team? What's the one area that causes you the biggest concern tonight?
Speed. You know, there's nobody slow. They don't have a slow player. There's no such thing as a slow player at Southeast High School. We got plenty of them.
Okay, Charlie, that was we got a chance to talk with John Sprague for a few moments, and it's the kind of thing, he made a very good point about Southeast and that speed they have at every position. He was talking about tackles, cornerbacks, running backs, everywhere. This Southeast team has that kind of speed.
That's exactly right, Jim. Southeast is extremely fast, and we know what they can do on offense. We know about Freddie Smith, and we know about Blakely, but their defense is quick as well. Their cornerbacks are quick. This is just a good, solid football team, and Coach Sprague realizes that, and he told about it.
Okay, and we had a few moments earlier ago. Charlie got a chance to talk with that man right there, Paul Meckley.
With me, Coach Paul Meckley from the Southeast Seminoles. He's the head coach here, and Coach, you're ranked number two tonight. Riverview's ranked number one in 5A, and what can we expect to see out of this game tonight?
Well, I think it's going to be a great midseason matchup between two teams over here on the Gulf Coast, and between Sarasota and Manatee County. It's a good rivalry. A couple other big teams don't have games in town, so it's going to be a big social event for a lot of people as well. But for the two football teams, it's going to be a good, hard-hitting football game, I think, between two fine squads.
Well, I want to congratulate you on a great program here at Southeast. Y'all have done real well, and especially since you've been head coach. And congratulations to you, and good luck tonight.
Well, thank you very much. We really appreciate it. It's been a good run so far, and we'd like to get back there in the state playoffs again and see if we can't bring one home here to Southeast that we haven't done.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Okay, those were our head coaches prior to the game. I'm Jim Brockman along with Charlie Wells. And, Charlie, this is the game we've been pointing to all year long. Looking forward to seeing these two undefeated teams play tonight, and Southeast is getting ready to kick off to Riverview. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, this is one, not since that opening week where we saw Riverview and Manatee, where Riverview at that time, it was an upset beating number one ranked in the country, Manatee. Looking forward to seeing them again tonight.
Well, we got a matchmaker's dream here, Jim. I'm really pleased to enjoy
the kicking it off deep. Taking it back there is Campbell, the fine cornerback for Riverview. He drops the football, and Southeast recovers. And that won't be a touchdown. It'll be a recovered fumble, Charlie. You can't advance it on a kick. But picking that thing up down there is number 14, James Booker. And what a horrible way for Riverview to start. Anthony Campbell drops the football on a great break for Southeast.
Well, Southeast just gets an unbelievable break right here on the kickoff, and that's exactly what they needed, because I'll tell you, I think they have to score just about every time they touch the ball here tonight, because Riverview will. And they've just got a great break here to punch it on in and probably score first.
That's remarkable. Southeast will have first and goal on the Riverview 5. And if Paul Meckley in his wildest dreams couldn't have asked for a better start to this game than that for the Southeast Seminoles. And you can see the Seminoles on that sideline, eager to go. Our quarterback tonight will be Edward Pollock. He missed last week's game, the senior starting quarterback with a sprained shoulder. Filling in for him and doing a great job was John Reeves, the fine sophomore quarterback. We might see him some. But Pollock will start tonight. He's a senior. Paul Meckley wanted to go with the experience. Reeves, known as a little better passer. And that's just a remarkable way to start off the game for Southeast. Of course, we should mention Riverview not only ranked number one in the state of Florida, but number 10 in the nation by the USA Today poll. Let's see what Southeast comes up with. First and 10 at the 10-yard line. Pitch goes back to Freddie Smith, and he's not going much of anywhere here, maybe a yard or two. He's hit there by Mike Hassav, number 55. Give him a yard on the play, it'll bring up second down and 9.
Well, I think we're going to see Freddie Smith carry the ball an awful lot, especially in this first half, because it's important that Southeast score. As we stated, they need to score just about every time they touch the football, and Freddie Smith is the guy that can do that. And I think you'll see him carry just an awful lot, especially in the first half.
Of course, Freddie Smith comes into tonight's game just through four games. He's rushed for 634 yards for an outrageous 10.2 average. He scored 8 touchdowns on the ground. He's caught 3 more. He's Mr. Everything for Southeast. That's number 10. And he'll get the ball again on delayed handoff. He's got a lot of company back in that backfield wearing those white shirts, and he's tackled for a loss. Getting back there first was number 26, safety man Jeff Guy.
Riverview defense is looking good on these first two plays, and Jeff Guy got in on Freddie Smith and turned him around and made that tackle. But that's real good pursuit by Riverview. Now, the time that we saw them play Manatee 3 or 4 weeks ago, this defense was a little bit suspect, but they look like they've been working on it, Jim, and they've improved.
They've certainly shut down Freddie Smith on Southeast's first two plays from scrimmage. As we said, he came in with that 10.2 average per carry, and he's carried a couple times for a loss of 3 yards here tonight. This time, Pollock will keep it, and he'll get back inside the 10, but that'll bring up fourth down from about the 8-yard line. And a tough decision here early, Charlie. You get the ball down there at the 10-yard line, maybe we'll see a field goal attempt here.
Well, I think you will see a field goal attempt. It's important for them to score first, and Coach Meckley knows that. So he'll try to just kick it through here now and just kind of take his lumps and kick the ball through and go ahead and kick the ball off to Riverview.
Kerry Ward will attempt the field goal attempt, and they're going to fake it. Danny Dunbar hangs on to it. He's inside the 10, but he will not score. He is stopped right at the 5-yard line, so the Seminoles get fancy. It doesn't pay off. And, Charlie, that's got to be a big swing in momentum. Southeast looks like they have a 6 points gift wrap, but they can't punch it in. They come away with no points.
Well, I'm wondering if that wasn't a bad snap, and I don't know if we'll get to see that again, but I believe it was a bad snap and certainly not an intentional run there. But that does hurt when you get the ball that far down in Riverview's territory and you don't score. I can tell you they'll come back to haunt you.
So the Rams have dodged the proverbial bullet. And you'll see for the first time in their number 7, Bernard Marshall. He was a running back last year. He's a quarterback. Straight ahead, the first man through, that's Darrington Abner, the guy who John Sprague, Riverview coach, referred to as definitely a Division I prospect prior to the game. Doesn't get much ink and much press because he's back there with the super sophomore, number 34, Sean Bain. And we're looking forward to seeing him. He comes into tonight's game in 4 games with 705 yards rushing, a 12.4 average, and 8 touchdowns. Remarkable season thus far for Sean Bain. Second down and 8 for Riverview. And that's Marshall trying to do something in the backfield. He's dumped for a loss getting back there first. Nate Simmons, number 5.
Well, I doubt very seriously that Riverview has played a team all year with a defense like Southeast has. Southeast has Rich Frost, McGreed, and Robick at the linebacking position, in addition to Tim Swan and Mike Davis that fill in back there. And I can tell you, they can really be rough, and they pursue extremely well. This is a tough defense that Southeast has.
Riverview looking at a 3rd down and 6 now from its own 9-yard line. And there's Sean Bain, the first time he's touched the ball. And he's not going very far. Getting back there to get a hand on him first was Mike McGreed. He also got some help back there from Rich Frost. And just what you were talking about, Charlie, Sean Bain, he comes in with a 12.4-yard average. No, nothing doing that time.
If you'll keep your eye on numbers 45, 61, and 33, you'll see an awful lot of tackles here. And if you'll just watch McGreed get in on this tackle right here, and he stops Sean Bain for no gain. Just great play on the behalf of the linebackers. And this is a good crop of linebackers at Southeast.
Back to kick is Chris Hackett, the guy John Sprague says is the best kicker in this area on a high school level, kicker and punter. That one's nice and high, not going real far. It's going to bounce and take a little bit of a Riverview roll. And Dunbar tries to pick it up on the run. Not smart. He fumbles it. So Dunbar, Southeast would have had great field position in Riverview territory, but Dunbar wanted to go someplace with it. He fumbles it. Riverview recovers. So now Riverview with the big break.
Dunbar just makes a bad mistake right here, because this ball should have just allowed to go dead, and instead he tries to pick it up and do a surprise run, but he can't get a handle on it. As you can see, he just kind of tips it here, and it rolls right out of his hand. Riverview recovers. They're in good field position, and this is where you don't want to have Riverview start carrying the ball on you at the 45-50-yard line.
Marcel Caston recovered it, and there goes Sean Bain, the young sophomore up near midfield. Rich Frost got him around the ankles. And I think the key there tonight, Charlie, with Sean Bain, arguably the best running back in the state as just a sophomore, is to gang tackle. Paul Meckley was talking before the game that they have to pursue. Southeast is known for that with all that speed on defense. They have to get to Sean Bain before he gets started. You can't let him get that head of steam into the secondary.
Sean Bain is 5'10". He weighs 190 pounds, and we pointed out he's only a sophomore, but he looks bigger than that, and he runs like an extremely big back.
There he is again. He'll be short of a first down, drags a couple tacklers with him down to about the 47. And there's big Reggie Green, number 76, Mr. Everything, usually an offensive lineman, but he'll go both ways tonight to try and slow down Sean Bain and the rest of the Rams, number 76.
Back to Sean Bain, Jim. Every time he touches the ball, he gains 12 yards. That's just a remarkable story in the first 4 games at Riverview.
So the Rams trying to get it going now, faced with 3rd down and 2. We have no score, just underway at the Southeast 47. And it's Abner, the first man through. It looks like he's got enough yardage for the first down as he crosses the 45-yard line, hit there first by Cornelius Hicks along with Charlie Higdon. So the Rams pick up that first down. And Charlie, regardless of the outcome of this game, you got to wonder if Southeast will think back to that first missed opportunity when they had the ball at the 10-yard line after the opening kickoff was fumbled.
I'm sure it'll be on their mind, but what they need to do now is just get it off their mind and get back to playing Southeast football if they want to stay in the game with Riverview.
And that's Bernard Marshall hangs on to it. He doesn't go anywhere, trying to run an option, but he got stopped before he got started. Down there hitting him first was Rick Robick, number 33.
Jim, Riverview scores an awful lot of points in the game. They beat Manatee 35-28. They beat Seminole 64-0. Martin County 52-20. And Pinellas Park 42-0. This is an offensive-minded football team, in addition to shutting out 2 of their opponents this year.
Something to keep an eye on, too, Charlie, is Bernard Marshall, number 7, the quarterback, limping a little bit after that last carry. We'll see how he is. And we know how Sean Bain is. He's feeling fine as he gets a first down inside the 30. Broke it out to the outside before James Booker made the tackle. And it was Booker who recovered that fumble that didn't result in any Southeast points. So first down, Riverview.
We've seen Sean Bain do this time and time again, especially against Manatee. If you let him get to the outside, brother, he is tough. You see, he's got deceptive speed, and he's hard to tackle. You have to really get down low on him and throw a good tackle on him. He does not fall down. A great runner.
So the Rams now threatening to score in Southeast territory. First and 10 at the 30-yard line. They love to keep it on the ground. You won't see him air it out too much. And there's Darrington Abner straight ahead, pounding away for 5 to the 25-yard line. Abner, 6 foot, 225 pounds, senior fullback, perfect size for the position.
You know, Abner not only is a good ball carrier, I think he's carried for over 200, maybe 225, 226 yards this year, but he's also a good blocker. He just he really complements Bain extremely well. He's a great blocker up front.
And you mentioned, Charlie, he has carried for, you almost forget about him, with 249 yards. That's nothing to laugh about either. A little overshadowed by Bain. And there goes Bain inside the 20 for a first down to the 13. Once again, Booker has to drag him down in the secondary along with Danny Dunbar. Another Riverview first down. You look at that Southeast coaching staff trying to come up with some answers.
Go right now. Let's go, go. What Southeast has to do here when Sean Bain touches the ball is the outside linebackers and the corners have got to force him back to the middle. If you let him get outside on you, he will absolutely eat you up.
And they're going to keep it inside with Abner. He'll get inside the 10, a steady four-yard gain. Frost makes the tackle. And I noticed there, Charlie, a little confusion on that Southeast sideline. They were trying to get big offensive lineman number 67, Jeremiah Joyner, in the game before that play. That time they got him in there, it was too late to get him in on the previous play.
I think when they get inside the 20, you're going to see Jeremiah and Reggie in the ball game because, you know, they don't want to play both ways the entire game. But when they get inside the 20, they're going to try to keep them from scoring.
So it'll be second down and six. And there's Sean Bain. He's inside the five. He's got it. A 10-yard touchdown run for Sean Bain. And Riverview, after fumbling the opening kickoff, they held Southeast out of the end zone. They come back, recover a fumbled punt by Danny Dunbar. And Sean Bain gave him an opportunity with good field position. He'll score from 10 yards out. Riverview draws first blood, 6-0 with 3:25 to go, first quarter. We wait for our extra point attempt. Chris Hackett, number one. Kick is up. Looks good from here. The officials agree. So with 3:25 to go in our first quarter, Riverview 7, Southeast nothing. And, Charlie, I'll tell you what, that's one of those things, the early breaks of the game, it looked like Southeast had things their way with that fumbled kickoff. Let's take a look at the touchdown run here.
Well,
first.
Sean Bain just runs this thing right off the tackle, and as you can see, he's a tough runner and moves it right on in to score. As I read that, that's his ninth touchdown on the year. He's just a tough football player. And I'll tell you, Southeast really has to, you got a key on him because he'll do that to you all night. And we've watched him play, and we carry on and on about how great he is. But he truly is that great. And if they don't contain him, he will absolutely win this ball game. Now, I know Coach Sprague said that one man don't
right.
do it, but this guy comes pretty close.
He's as close as you get. So it is 7-0. Riverview has taken the lead and quieted this home Southeast crowd. I've never seen more folks here at Southeast Stadium. Officially holds about 4,200 people. We got that and then some. We got people standing all over. Might have double that 4,200 number with folks standing all along outside the running track. Hackett kicks it off. Beautiful looking kick. He's chasing Smith back to his goal line. Freddie Smith to the 10-15. Trying to get up ahead of steam. Here comes Freddie Smith. He's up near midfield. He'll be driven out at about the 47. And Freddie Smith, he has to, tackling him was kicker Chris Hackett, saving the touchdown. So Southeast, their best play of the night, that fine kickoff return by Freddie Smith.
Well, I knew this was going to be an exciting game tonight because anytime you get Freddie Smith and Sean Bain in the same game, you're going to really see some action. And fans get a chance there to see exactly what Freddie Smith can do. He's fast and he runs well, too. You see, Freddie Smith takes this kickoff. And as soon as he gets his hands on it, this guy's thinking about scoring. He takes the ball, comes back to the near side, and just drives right on through. Should have been tackled right there, and really there's only one man between him and the end zone.
And the kicker got him. That was Chris Hackett. So Southeast with great field position at their own 47. First man through, Mike Blakely, the fullback, little or nothing. He's hit right away by Jack Owsley, big 6'2", 257-pound junior lineman. Owsley on the stop. Maybe a yard on the play. It'll be second down and nine. So, Charlie, already we've gotten our money's worth. A couple of turnovers. Riverview's turnover did not cost them. Southeast fumbling the punt did cost them. Bain took it on in for a touchdown eventually. Now Southeast trying to get back and play their kind of game, that methodical offense, and punch it down the field. Second down, nine for the Seminoles. Running out of the eye. It's a second man through Freddie Smith. He'll cross into Riverview territory to about the 47. Hit there by Alex Graydon. And that'll leave him about 4 yards shy of that first down. Third and four.
Jim, I think until Southeast establishes themselves on offense here, I think you're going to see him kind of stick behind Reggie Green and Jeremiah, because that's a safe place to run. And as you can see, Freddie picks up about six there just by running straight up behind the big guys.
And you look at Paul Meckley there, head football coach for Southeast. He's been looking forward to this one all year. Got a packed house and then some here at Southeast Stadium. Looking for their first points of the night are the Seminoles. Third and fourth, 47 of Riverview. If the Pollock keeps it, he fumbles the football. And recovering for Riverview, that's number 80, Robert Brown. So Southeast with two very costly fumbles. And now they turn it back over to that powerful Riverview offense. With good field position, Riverview will be at their own 40-yard line.
Well, this is the very thing that Southeast didn't want to do. They get the ball here, and you know that they want to hang on. They want to get the first down, but instead, and just trying to pull another yard or two so they can get that first down, it just falls out of his hand. Riverview has the ball again. Bad news for Southeast.
So Pollock, who missed last week's game with a sprained shoulder, fumbles. And there's Darrington Abner. Look out. The big man's on a roll, and he's inside the 35 near the 30-yard line. Before he can be dragged down by Anthony Rawls, 5'7" Anthony Rawls. And Abner showed us a little speed there. When you get that much, that 225 pounds going one way, he just started rolling. A gain of about 29 on the play.
Well, Abner just takes this ball, looks like a little trap play, just right up the middle, right off the guard. And thank goodness that Rawls for Southeast, thank goodness he's a great pursuer. He just stuck with him and made the tackle.
And they go right back to Abner. This time he gets about three. Coming up from a secondary spot, Dunbar hits him along with number 45, Rich Frost. So Riverview with those two great running backs, prototypes. Fullback Darrington Abner, 6'2", 225. Sean Bain, 5'10", 190. And they've been moving the football all year long. And let's take a look at Reggie Green there, number 76. And Charlie, I was reading in the Sporting News earlier this week. Now, this guy's considered the top prospect as an offensive lineman in the United States as far as going into college and playing football at 6'8", 295. So there's a guy to keep your eye on.
Coach Meckley calls him the future Henry Lawrence.
I believe it. Straight ahead, trying to get some. Well, let's see if we have a loose ball down there. Southeast believes they do. Getting the carry that time was Jason Siegel. And he got popped there in a hurry by Nate Simmons. Mike McGreed was also back there. And Siegel barely hangs on, number 32. He'll lose a couple on the play. It'll bring up third down and eight.
Well, that time Robick and McGreed come in and they force the play back and do a great job in holding Riverview. And that's something that's been missing here. Now, the first series, they held extremely well, but then they got a little bit of lax. Now they seem to have got back into sync.
Riverview on top, 7-0. We're down to 18 seconds and counting left in our first quarter. And we've got flags all over the place as Bernard Marshall tries to take the snap. Somebody moved too early. Procedure is the call against Riverview. So third down and 7 now becomes third down and 12 for the Rams. As we wait for them. Yeah, and of course we want to thank our sponsors who make tonight's game possible and all the games we do here on Paragon Cable. Subway, subs done my way. Coastal Printing, featuring high quality commercial printing, color, image setting, and design. You can see the difference, phone 351-1515. And Mix and Fruit, Southern goodness for over 50 years. They open up October 25th. Marshall with the handoff to Sean Bain on third and long. He's back to about the 30s. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, Chris Hackett wasn't lacking any length there. He kicked that thing. It could have gone about 57 yards, but he was just a little wide to the right.
Hackett has an excellent leg, and we were talking just on during the break there, Jim, and against Manatee, they were going for the field goal, and we saw a fake field goal,
right.
And this time we were looking for it, but Hackett goes ahead and kicks it. He's got good distance. He's just a little bit wide. You can see that kick would have probably went for 52, 53-yarder
right.
Had he been more accurate.
And you got to watch the Rams on that, because sophomore Tim Alexander, considered a better thrower than Bernard Marshall, the starting quarterback, is the holder on those kicking attempts, and he can throw the football very well, something to keep your eye on. But Southeast holds them. The field goal is missed. They'll start from their own 20-yard line with Pollock at quarterback. Running out of the eye, trailing 7-0. We're just underway in our second quarter. Thank you for joining us here on Paragon Cable Channel 22. Blakely, nothing doing, maybe loses a yard on the play as he's hit by Jack Owsley, who's really anchoring the interior part of that defensive line for Riverview. Second down, 11.
Riverview's doing a good job, especially right up front right now. And, you know, it, just in the back of your mind, I don't want to try to second-guess Coach Meckley or even predict what he will do, but you remember John Reeves really threw right. that ball good last week, and if they can't establish a running game here, you just never know. They may go to John Reeves. Pollock's arm is still bothering him, so don't know if he can throw or not.
And Reeves is quite a passer. He's just a sophomore, an excellent drop-back passer. Even run the ball a little bit. Pollock's going to try, but he's not going to get a chance. If blitzing from the outside there is Jason Siegel, who's played some running back tonight. Pollock never even got a chance really to look downfield as he was sacked.
Well, this is a great play by Jason Siegel. You know, he's the forgotten back in that wishbone offense for Riverview, but he plays both ways, and nobody touches him. He just goes in and sacks Pollock as he's trying to throw the ball. So the first time we really get to see Southeast maybe attempt to throw it, it's a quarterback sack.
Dumped back at about his 10-yard line, loss of 9. So now Southeast with a very tough 3rd and 19. We'll call it the 11-yard line, just outside the 10. We've got 3 wide receivers to the near side of the field. Pollock's the quarterback.
See if they run right.
And they're going to run that option. As Pollock, he stumbles as he tries to get out there, and he maybe gets back to the line of scrimmage. Anthony Campbell hits him, number 3. And I'll tell you what, Southeast offense really sputtering. And Campbell, Charlie, we remember back to that opener when they upset Manatee, when Riverview won that game. He intercepted a pass and also ran a punt back. So Anthony Campbell, a very versatile athlete, number 3. We might see him play some wide receiver yet tonight, too.
Campbell's a good one, and we may get a chance to see him return here. He can do that extremely well.
And Kerry Ward has to now stand in the shadow of his own end zone and punt it. And now Southeast having trouble with their punting team getting it on the field. They've had to call a timeout here. I'm sure they didn't want to waste one at that point facing 4th down and 20. But they will stop the clock with 9:55 left to go in our second quarter. And Charlie, you got to wonder here a little bit if Southeast doesn't have a few opening night butterflies or something here tonight. I mean, we've watched them play 2 or 3 games this year. We've had for folks here locally in Manatee County, and they've just looked superb. They've run over people. The defense has played well. They just seem they're not quite firing tonight. A couple of turnovers in that first quarter, having to waste a timeout there. I just wonder if it's a case of jitters.
Well, Riverview is not number 1 in the state by accident.
Right.
They surely deserve it, and they're a good football team. And I think what Southeast is seeing right now, they're seeing the best football team that they've played all year, obviously. And so this is going to be a special game for them and a real challenge. And it won't be like some of their other opponents where they've just taken the ball and run
right.
at will. They'll have to really work for this one tonight.
Kerry Ward kicking from inside his own goal line. It's a good-looking snap. They've got the return on. A short wobbly punt, and see if it takes a Southeast roll. It does a little bit. It'll be downed at about the 41-yard line of Southeast, so only about a 30-yard punt, and Riverview will have great field position at the Southeast 41.
And you see Jim Big Jeremiah Joyner, he comes up, he downs the punt and makes it dead, and then he turns right around and gets on defense. So he'll be a tired cookie after this game is over.
But you've got to have your best players out there. Joyner and, like we've mentioned, Reggie Green. See a lot of folks going both ways tonight for Riverview as well. They've got great field position. They lead 7-0, 9:29 to go first half. And there's big Darrington Abner just battering away inside. Reggie Green, number 76, hits him there. He gets about 5 down to the 36-yard line. And it's interesting to note, Charlie, that it seems like compared to that Manatee game, they're going to Darrington Abner a lot more. It's not all Sean Bain left, Sean Bain right. He's carrying the ball a lot and getting those 4 or 5 solid yards inside a pop.
And he's a big back, too, and he runs extremely well, and he carries people with him when he runs.
2nd down, 5 for the Rams. And there's Sean Bain, and he's got a 1st down. He's inside the 30. Making a good hit up there right away was number 21, Matt Payne. But even so, Charlie, that shows Sean Bain's talent real well there. Payne hit him right at the line of scrimmage, had him wrapped up, but Bain still gets 6 or 7 yards before you can bring him down.
I think the key to stopping either one of these backs is to hit them low. I don't think you can tackle them up high. I know you can't tackle Abner up high. And Sean Bain, even though he's a little bit shorter, you still got to hit him low. You got to get him around the ankles or he's not going to fall.
So the Rams keep pounding away, and there's Abner getting 2 or 3 yards the hard way. He was hit immediately upon taking the handoff by number 33, Rick Robick, but still got about 3. It'll bring up 2nd down, 7. And another thing this Riverview attack does, Charlie, is it eats up a lot of time. They've yet to throw a pass tonight, and unless they have to, they won't. And it takes up a lot of time.
We said when they played number 1 ranked Manatee, we said that they wanted to keep the ball away from Manatee, and that's exactly what they did. And that seems to be their game plan here tonight against Southeast. Just keep the ball away from them. Just keep it in the entire half, and that way nobody can score on you. And that seems to work.
So we have a brief officials timeout here. I think we're changing footballs, and now the clock starts again, running at 8:07. 2nd down, 8. And that's Marshall going nowhere and really reading that option beautifully. It was Rich Frost, 6'3", 200-pound junior linebacker, and he read that. He took that right out of the textbook, tackles him for a couple-yard loss, brings up 3rd down.
On November 15th, Jim, they will have their homecoming game here at this stadium, and that is when they will dedicate it to former coach John Kiker, who's
right.
deceased, and they will be dedicating this football field to Coach Kiker, and we look forward to that.
It meant a lot to Southeast Athletic Program, and we'll be renaming this refurbished stadium. And as you can see, as you look on at home, the stands are filled, and those folks you see standing are outside the running track there. Just, I'd say we've got about double. We're pushing 8,000-9,000 folks here tonight. 3rd down and 9 for the Rams. And here's our first pass of the night. Marshall gets off a little screen, and who came up with it? It finally falls incomplete. Looked like Frost almost was going to come up with the interception. Reggie Green got a big hand on it as well.
Well, Reggie almost picked off one here, and I'm telling you.
I'd love to see him run that football.
I'd really like to see that. I'm almost, you know, we're supposed to be neutral up here, but I'd like to see him catch that and run with it. I don't know if he could take it down the field or not, but almost picked him off one.
At 6'7", 295, though, it would be fun to watch. I'd like to see someone try and knock him down. And now we got Hackett back on to try another field goal. He's got the leg. It'll be a 43-yard attempt. It's up. It's definitely long enough. But once again, he's wide, and Hackett is just drilling the football. He just can't find the uprights. His second missed field goal here. So Southeast with another good defensive stand, and those two missed field goals could figure highly in this game, Charlie. It still remains 7-0 on the strength of that 10-yard run by Sean Bain back in the first quarter. So Southeast takes over at their own 20 once again.
They're biting the bullet and dodging the bullet, excuse me. And I can tell you that Southeast needs to get something generated with that offense right now. And I don't expect them to run for big yardage against the way this Riverview defense has been playing, but I can tell you they better start getting some first downs.
Yeah, the Southeast has really shown us nothing yet offensively, and that's unlike them. We'll talk about their offensive production here in a minute. They're going to the air with Pollock, throws it out there to Southeast leading receiver Brian Reed, maybe a yard or two. I'm not even sure if he got back to that line of scrimmage. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, the biggest surprise of the game thus far to me tonight is that Riverview has played so well defensively, or not just well, but have just shut down Southeast. Southeast came into this game averaging 36.5 points a game, well over 300 yards in offense, and the Rams have just shut them down.
They've studied their game films extremely well, and it shows. You can tell that they're well coached, and you can tell that they know exactly what Southeast is going to do, and I think that's the reason Southeast is going to have to change their offense a little bit if they want to move the ball on them. I'm sure they do.
That was Charlie Brown, number 6, a defensive back. Hope he's okay. It looks like they're looking at his shoulder. He's taking off his pads for the time being. And here comes Freddie Smith, who does get some positive yardage to about the 24, but well shy of a first down. It'll bring up 3rd down and 6. Making the tackle down there, Alex Grayton.
Our referees tonight, Jim, Dick Redman. Our umpire is Ed Wettinger. Our line judge is Bruce Hermanson. The linesman, Tom Jackson. The back judge is Bill Repper. And the clock operator is Russ Mulger.
And Southeast looking, they need to get to that 30-yard line. Looking for that initial first down of the game. Trying to get something going with senior quarterback Ed Pollock. He's going to throw it, and he's got a man open. A nice-looking catch out there. And that's, I believe, is Reed. Let's see if that's number 7.
Brian Reed.
Brian Reed. does make the catch, and that's what he can do. He's Southeast's leading receiver. He came into tonight with 14 catches for 179 yards. We'll take another look at the fine catch by Reed.
Well, you see why Brian Reed is number one in Manatee County in receiving right now. He just grabs that ball, and he also runs well after he makes the catch. You see, he avoids three or four tacklers and turns that into a great game.
And that's the first real sign of life for Southeast offensively. That's Anthony Campbell, the fine sophomore cornerback, making the stop. Southeast to their own 45-yard line, first and 10. 5:39 left to go in our first half. There's the option play. Here comes Freddie Smith. He got that block he needed on the outside. He turns it up and is near midfield. We'll give him about five on the play, chasing him down. Brian Gillen, number 54, along with Campbell, and Alex Graydon, number 15, looking like, oh, he's holding a knee, and we hate to see that. And we'll have an official's timeout here. And Alex Graydon, number 15, 5'10", 156-pound senior defensive back. And, of course, we want to thank one of our sponsors tonight, Subway. Subs done my way here in Manatee County. We want to thank everyone along the Sunshine Network for joining us this evening, and we hope you enjoy the football here on the west coast of Florida with always good year in and year out, Charlie, with Manatee High School, Bradenton Southeast, and, of course, those schools in Sarasota. Sarasota Riverview, Sarasota High School. We're seeing a couple of them tonight. Let's take a look at the...
Well, here's the reason Freddie Smith is so good, Jim. You see, Sean Bain is just kind of a straight-up runner. He runs right over you. Freddie Smith can make all the moves. He puts all the moves on you, cuts back, and just does it all. He's a great runner as well, fabulous runner.
And in looking at that replay, Charlie, it made me wince a little bit. I saw Alex Graydon was down at the bottom of that pile, and you saw he had that his foot back behind him there, and... A whole lot of weight came down on top of him, and I'm afraid he got that foot caught, and that's what caused the knee problem.
They're spending an awful lot of time with him down here, and they're very careful not to move him around. So I would imagine that he's either got some severe ankle or knee problems.
Of course, Sarasota, look at the folks here tonight. We've got the 4,500 seats filled up, plus if you can count them along the sidelines, you're a better mathematician than I am. We got folks lined all the way around the field here on the running track. And you look at Alex Graydon, that doesn't look good. He's not putting any weight on that right knee whatsoever. We wish him the best.
I'm just glad to see him really up and off and instead of having to bring a stretcher over for him, because that gives a little hope there. I'm sorry to see the young man injured, but I can say there's promise when they lift him up and take him off like this.
And it's second down and five. Of course, Sarasota Riverview made it all the way to the Class 5A championship game last season before they were defeated by Fort Walton Beach Choctaw 13-10 in that final.
Choctawhatchee, how well
That's
we
right.
know that school.
I was going to say Choctawhatchee, but I never pronounced it right, so I kind of shortened it to Choctaw.
Those people know how to play football out
yes,
there. We'll give them that.
Out in the panhandle. And, of course, Southeast looking for their seventh consecutive district championship. They've made it to the state finals in Class 4A twice in the last 5 years, so we've got a couple of experienced programs here used to playing playoff football in December here in Florida. Southeast faced with second down and five. Pollock with the pitch back to Smith. He lowers his head. He's short of a first down. He's hit there first by big Mike Hassab, 6'2", 214-pound defensive end. Decent gain on the play, but he'll be 3 yards shy. And I'll tell you, Charlie, Riverview's not giving up anything without a fight. Every yard Southeast is having to really work for.
Well, Pollock has the authority from Coach Meckley. He can check off at the line of scrimmage, and obviously on that option play, it's his pick as to where the toss is made, and he has to read the tackle on the right side in that particular instance, and he does a pretty good job with that. The offense isn't gelling as well tonight as we've seen it, but he does a great job with that.
And Pollock keeps it. Here comes the late pitch to Smith. He breaks one tackle, and he's awfully close to the first down. He's dropped right at the 45 by Jeff Guy.
I believe he's got it, Jim.
Looks like he does. He maybe with a foot to spare. So Southeast, that's three straight carries by Freddie Smith, and he got 10 yards and a foot, but it's enough to keep possession. Let's take another look.
This is just what the doctor ordered here for Southeast. He pitches that ball off to Freddie Smith, and Freddie just on his own there gets just a couple of extra feet and gets the first down. Southeast really needed that first down to keep the ball moving right here.
And keep the ball out of the Rams' hands. Right now, we're still sitting on that 7-0 score. We got 3:59 to go in the first half. Riverview still on top. Southeast starting to move the football. First and 10 at the Riverview 45. Pollock fakes to Blakely. He's going up top. He's got a man deep. And making the catch over his shoulder is Calvin Reeves. Beautiful catch down to the 15, a gain of 30 yards, and that was a sweet-looking catch, Charlie.
Just a phenomenal catch by Reeves there. I don't know how in the world he hung on to that thing. And, you know, I'm not too sure that he wasn't interfered with as he went out for the catch, but a great over-the-shoulder catch.
And that's the toughest kind of thing to catch, Charlie, I think, coming right straight over your head. But he made a beautiful play on it. It'll give Southeast a first down at the 15, and they are threatening to tie this thing up. And we're going to take another look. I believe we've got that for you. Let's take a look at this catch.
Yeah, you see him, Pollock just dropped back, and he throws that thing over the, and you see Calvin Reeves just makes the over-the-shoulder catch and then keeps on running and stays inbound, keeps on running with it for additional yardage.
And fairly well covered. Pollock goes right back to the air. Touchdown! Right back to Calvin Reeves. And just that quickly, Southeast makes it 7-6 as we wait for our extra point attempt. Or wait a second, was that Reed? We might have to check that, whether that was Reed or Kelvin Reeves, number 7 and number 8 respectively. We'll check that, make sure we find out who made that touchdown catch.
Well, here we look at it again. We see Pollock back up here, and was it Kelvin Reed? Kelvin Reed makes the catch, does he not?
It is Kelvin Reed.
He's wide open in the end zone.
We were right the first time. It was Kelvin Reeves. Brian Reed in there for a quick celebration, and Ward belts it through, and we're all tied up with 3:14 to go in the first half. We've got a great one for you. It's all tied up, 7-7. And Charlie, after Southeast shook off a few early butterflies, this thing's, we weren't lying to people. This is building into a game that is one you're going to want to watch right on through to the bitter end, because we're 7-7 in the second quarter. Two great football teams, and we're just getting underway here.
Well,
this is starting to get interesting.
This is the kind of game we'd hope for, because we've been up here when there'd been a couple of blowouts, and
right.
Obviously you and I had run out of things to talk about in some of them. But
which is easy to do.
Yeah, that's exactly right. But tonight we see, like we said, a matchmaker's
right.
dream, and here in the first half it's proven to be just that. And, you know, I don't know if that's part of the strategy or not on Coach Meckley and Scotty Taylor, the offensive coordinator, but you notice they throw that ball to Brian Reed and kind of suck
right.
the defense over to his side, and then throw two in a row to Kelvin Reed, one for about a 30-yard gain, the other one for a touchdown. I don't know if it was planned that way just to suck them over to Brian Reed, but I can tell you it worked, and it was two good pass plays for Southeast, and they're on the board.
Ed Pollock has to like that, too. Everyone's been talking about how John Reeves, the backup, is the passer. Pollock showed he can throw the ball with anybody, too. And there's Campbell. He's dangerous return man, and he gets some decent yardage up to about the 35 before he's dragged down. Getting a shot in on him there was Rick Robick. So Riverview will start at 1st and 10 from their own 35, just over 3 minutes to go in our first half. We are all tied at 7 apiece. I'm Jim Brockman along with Charlie Wells. Thank you for joining us here on Paragon Cable, Channel 22, and all the folks along the Sunshine Network. 1st and 10 for the Rams. Bernard Marshall, still limping a little bit, is your quarterback. He gives it to the second man through, Sean Bain, and Bain will go nowhere. Hitting him up there quickly was Danny Dunbar, and I suppose Dunbar, he's a nice young man, Charlie. I've talked to him before, and I'm sure he still feels a little sick about dropping that punt in the first quarter that led to the Riverview score. He's trying to get even. He tackles Bain for a yard loss on that play.
Well, when I walked across the field while I go to talk to Coach Meckley, Danny Dunbar called my name. Charlie Wells, he said, call my number tonight. So we're doing it for you
we're
right
doing.
There, Danny.
You
great play.
You make the plays, we'll call it. Second down, 11 for the Rams. Marshall looking around, maybe he's changing the play at the line of scrimmage, and he's going to give it to the first man through, big Darrington Abner, and he's close to about the 39-yard line, well short of a first down. It'll be 3rd down and 6, and Southeast has called for a timeout. They're hoping to get the football back here on 3rd and 6 from Riverview. So the Seminoles thinking ahead, maybe trying to force Riverview to punt and get another shot at trying to punch some points in. We're all tied at 7 apiece, 2:13 left to go in our second quarter.
Well, we're going to be seeing Sean Bain around for quite some time, him being a sophomore, but another guy that's only a sophomore, and he's really had an impact on this Riverview team. They're rich in talent, is Anthony Campbell.
Right.
Campbell is 6'1", he's a 164-pounder, usually plays defensive back, but you see that he can return, and we watched him in earlier this year. He really, when he gets his hand on that football, on punt returns and kickoff returns, he really follows his blockers well. In fact, he delays until he gets just
right.
that little bit bit of edge, and then he is really a terror when you give him just one or two blocks. So it'd be exciting to watch tonight, and people can keep their eye on him during kickoffs and on punts.
So Southeast now hoping to force Riverview into a punting situation. Third down and six for the Rams, who admittedly they don't like to throw the football much. They like to give it to Abner and or Bain. And this will be Bain, and he's not going anywhere. There's that gang defense in Southeast. That's the key to Southeast trying to win. Four or five orange jerseys around the football, and they've done that on this series. The Rams will be forced to punt, gain of maybe a yard for Sean Bain.
Funny, you watch this Southeast defense, they absolutely swarm, and this is because they're coached so well by defensive coach coordinator Faust DeLazier. You can see they're about six jerseys around on that particular tackle there, and that's exactly what they like to do. We've talked about this before. The defense on Southeast, they watch the guards. They do not watch the running back. They say that you can tell where the play is going to go 75% of the time if you watch the offensive guards. A well-coached defense.
So fourth down and four now. Clock running, and of course Riverview in no hurry to punt the football to give it back to Southeast. But this is costing Southeast some valuable seconds after getting a taste of that end zone on the previous possession. And now the Rams will be called for delay of game. They're not worried about that. Now the Hackett will come out to punt the football. So you got to go back, Charlie, in the second quarter. Hackett misses a couple of field goals. Granted, they were long shots of 142 yards, 147. But he was wide on both of them, plenty long. Southeast comes back to tie it up. When the passing game gets clicked in, and we're all tied at seven, Southeast looking to do something here with 1:17 left to go in the first half. Hackett gets off a fairly decent punt. It's angling towards the sideline. And that was probably a good idea, Charlie. You've got guys like Freddie Smith and Danny Dunbar back there to return it. The last thing you need if you're John Sprague in Riverview is someone returning that thing for a big gain, and Southeast is capable of that. They'll have it first and 10.
Freddie Smith is a threat. We've said that. He's a threat every time he gets his hand on that ball, and no matter whether he's returning punts or whether he's running the ball out of tailback position. But what we need to watch here now is to see if Eddie Pollock goes again, comes back to Kelvin Reed or Reeves and Brian Reed, those two receivers. And these guys are extremely fast when they catch the ball, and they're a real threat to score as well. So let's see if they come back to the pass play, Jim, because that is really the only thing that has been successful against this Riverview defense thus far.
And Southeast, Ed Pollock, he's known as the option quarterback here at Southeast, but he's thrown the ball very well here in the second quarter. And let's see here, our officials and official timeout there. But now the clock is running. Stopped at 1:11. So Southeast, with 60 yards to go, they're at their own 40-yard line, wanting to get at least close enough for maybe a Kerry Ward field goal. Of course, they'd love to get seven. Three wide receivers to the near side of the field. One lone running back. And here comes Pollock. He's going right to the air. Here comes the big rush. The screen is set up to the short side of the field. And that's Freddie Smith. Look out. Freddie Smith on a roll inside the 30 before he's driven out of bounds. And that was a beautiful play, Charlie. They brought all the receivers to the wide side of the field, brought all the attention over, then snuck in that screen to the short side of the field. It paid off.
Absolutely a beautiful call by Southeast. Coach Meckley, I'm sure, he drew, just like you said, Jim, he draws everybody to this side, and then he throws off to the safety valve, Freddie Smith. And, of course, Freddie has nobody out there in front of him, and a big gainer for Freddie Smith. And, of course, he's fast when he gets the ball as well.
And that was also a good fake by Paul. He looked to that wide side of the field, had everyone from Riverview going to the strong side, and Freddie Smith slips in for about a 33-yard gain going the other way.
It showed a lot of poise on that play.
Really did. First and 10 at the 28. 1 minute to go in the first half. Southeast looking to take the lead. Fakes a handoff to Smith. Pollock's got time. Throws over the middle. Reeves, does he make the catch or did he trap it? Now, one official ruled catch, one ruled incomplete. So take your pick. Zeeny, meeny, miny, mo time.
Well, I think the referee that ruled that he trapped it is correct. It looked like to me it was a trap ball from up here, but we'll look at
it
again.
They're bringing it back.
Yeah, they're bringing it back and calling it an incomplete.
At the 28-yard line. One official said he caught it. The other one said no way. And it'll be second down and 10. Play only took 6 seconds, so Southeast will try it again from the 28-yard line of Riverview. Pollock, the quarterback. Dropping straight back. No play action. He's not going to fool anybody. He's just going to roll left. He's going to get the pass off. It's caught. Brian Reed inside the 20. He'll be short of a first down. And look at Reed saying, let's hurry up. We don't have a whole lot of time. And he's right. 39 seconds and counting. Southeast needs to get a playoff, but they got to get the first down. It's third down and two. 30 seconds remain. And they're going to run it to get the Pollock. Smith has the first down inside the 15-10. He's down to the 7, and that will stop the clock momentarily to move the chains. It will be first and goal, but will Southeast have time? I think they've spent, I believe that's their final time out of the half, Charlie. We'll check on that. And well, this gets very interesting, first and goal now. Freddie Smith with a nice-looking play.
Well, we're located over on the southeast side of the field, and I can tell you that these people are stirred up right now. All of the Southeast fans are standing. They know they only have 19 seconds to punch this thing in. I agree with you. We don't have a count on the timeouts, but I believe they've used their last one. And Southeast has got everybody in this ballpark, all of their fans involved in this game. This is quite a show right here tonight.
And I'll tell you what, Charlie, Southeast has always had great fan support over here at Bradenton Southeast, but I've never seen them quite this boisterous, quite this fired up, waiting for that number one Class 5A team in Riverview. They have packed this place, lined the track, as good a support as they've had. This is the most interest I've seen in a Southeast game over the years.
I tell you what you got to like about these fans, Jim, is they really appreciate defense. I mean, they stand up and cheer for their defense just like they do the offense. And I really like that when you got a sports fans that are appreciate both sides of the ball. They appreciate the defense and the offense.
So 19 seconds remains. We're all tied at 7-7. 19 seconds to go in our first half. First and goal at the 7. There's the clock in the lower right hand of your screen. Here come the Seminoles looking to take a lead going into halftime. Pollock fakes a handoff. He's going to drift left. Reggie Green's out there blocking for him. He's going to tuck it under his arm. He's going to be inside the 5. He dives. He's dumped it about the 2.
Well, they're going to run out of time, I believe.
I think they're going to run out of time down on the 2-yard line, Charlie. They will. So Southeast gets it all the way down to the 2. They can't punch it in. They're out of timeouts. So even though we're tied at 7-7 here at halftime, a bit of a frustrating first half for Southeast. A couple of fumbles, and they run out of time at the 2-yard line. But the result is we're all tied at 7. And we should have a great second half for you. Don't go away. We'll have some great halftime entertainment coming up for you in just a few moments. In the second half after that, 7-7, Riverview and Southeast. Call earlier on in the second quarter, they had to burn a timeout to get the punt team on the field. And so the half ended with Southeast at the Riverview 2-yard line, but unable to stop the clock. We're at 7-7. We'll have some first half stats for you as we head on into the third quarter. Hackett kicks it off. It's a moonshot down to inside the 10. And that's Freddie Smith, and he's drilled. He won't get back to the 20. Putting a big hit on him there was Dan Pappas, number 44, a 6-foot, 170-pound defensive back. So Southeast will try it from their own 19-yard line, first and 10. And, Charlie, an interesting story in that first half. Southeast known so well for running the football, only 16 attempts, 42 yards. But what made the difference was Ed Pollock, not known for his throwing, was 6-for-7 for 105 yards, including that 15-yard touchdown pass to Kelvin Reeves.
Well, he learned he could throw that ball to Kelvin Reeves, and also you remember the one that he threw out into the backfield there to Freddie Smith.
Right.
And so I think they are going to have to throw because they haven't had much luck running that ball against this tough Riverview defense.
That's Brian Reed in motion, and they'll give it to Freddie Smith, the second man through, and Freddie has to work awful hard to get about 3 to the 22-yard line as he slips and falls down there. Covering him up was Robert Brown, number 80. Southeast with 6 first downs in that first half. Riverview had 5 first downs. Riverview, on the other hand, was able to run the football. Sean Bain, 10 carries for 53 yards. Darrington Abner, 8 carries for 57 yards. 22 carries for 112, 0-for-1 in the passing department. Those statistics courtesy of Mark Mooring from the Bradenton Herald. Second down, 7 for Southeast at their own 22-yard line. Pitch goes back to Freddie Smith. He's got a block on the outside and a first down across the 30, and that's the Southeast offense we're used to seeing as he drags it up to about the 44 before Robert Brown makes the tackle.
Well, that time, Jim, Freddie Smith shows us what he's made of, and really, like you said, that's kind of typical Freddie Smith. He's been used to running like that all year long. Of course, we pointed out he hasn't played a Riverview all year long, and that's the reason they have contained him a little bit better. They have a better defense. But watch this play as Freddie takes the ball, just really turns it out the outside, turns around the corner right up the sideline, and drags two or three defenders with him for another 5 yards. And we pointed out time and time again that Freddie Smith is a premier running back in Manatee County.
First and 10 Seminoles from their own 45, getting it started here in the second half. And there's Pollock. He breaks a tackle. He'll cross midfield. He's got another first down. He's inside the 40. Once again, Robert Brown has to make the stop. And Charlie, we mentioned it earlier, but Southeast has overcome some adversity. They had a couple of first half turnovers. They get frustrated getting all the way down to the 2-yard line, and time runs out on them in the first half, so they can't take the lead. But they're still coming back.
Eddie Pollock takes this ball, Jim, and it looks like he might hand it off. Instead, he just tucks it, and this is run all the way, Eddie Pollock. He has no intention of pitching that off on the option and takes it for a good game.
So Southeast moving the football, first and 10 at the 41-yard line of Riverview. So far, Southeast has kept the ball on the ground here in the second half, and they've had more success than they have at any time this evening. Now Pollock goes right back upstairs. He's got plenty of time. Gets a block back there from Smith. He gets the pass off. There's nobody out there. Just got rid of that thing. It'll bring up second down and 10.
That play was designed to go to Kelvin Reeves, and Kelvin went out, and Eddie Pollock couldn't spot him out there, and Reeves turns around and comes back, and really had he come back just a little bit sooner, he would have been able to make that catch. But Kelvin Reeves has made a super catch here tonight, and he is really responsible, I believe, for Southeast getting in the scoring position.
Well, once again, we want to welcome you to Paragon Cable Channel 22 and the folks along the Sunshine Network. I'm Jim Brockman, along with Charlie Wells. We've got a good one. We're all tied at 7 apiece, 10 minutes to go in our third quarter. Long count by Pollock. He's going to drop straight back. He's going back to the air. He's got time. It's a wobbler, but it's caught out there by Brian Reed. A great-looking catch. He was well covered. Robert Brown was all over him, but Reed makes the catch, and that's why he's Manatee County's leading receiver.
Brian Reed just does a super job here hanging on to the ball. He comes into this game with 14 receptions for 179 yards, and watch what a beautiful catch he makes. It's kind of an awkward position. Look, he just makes a nice catch with the defender holding on to him. Brian Reed is really a real sport. He knows how to catch that ball, and usually he makes good gainers after the catch.
Down to the 27, Southeast threatening, first and 10. Just underway here in the third quarter. We're all tied at 7. Pollock with a pitch back to Freddie Smith. He takes it outside. He breaks a tackle, and he won't get much more. He gets about 4, and he's hit there first by Jeff Guy, the senior safety man. We'll give him 4 on the play. It'll bring up second down and 6. So Southeast had trouble running the football in that first half with only 42 yards on the ground. Not having as much trouble here in the second half, getting it going here a little bit.
Coach Matt, Coach Marino.
Of course, our scoring, Sean Bain on a 10-yard run for Riverview in the first quarter. Hackett added the extra points, 7-0. Southeast came back. A 15-yard touchdown pass from Pollock to Kelvin Reeves. And Kerry Ward added the extra point, and that's where we stand at 7-7 with 8:53 to go in our third quarter. Second down, 7 for the Seminoles. Pollock fakes it to the first man through. He hangs on to it, breaks a tackle, and he's down to about the 17-yard line. He's close to another first down, and he's wrapped up there by Jeff Guy once again. Southeast shaking off that early bad start, shaking off the 2 early turnovers. Of course, Riverview had an early turnover. They fumbled the opening kickoff, did not hurt them. Southeast was unable to punch the ball in. And you hear the folks here on the Southeast side of the stadiums pounding their feet. We've got about 8,500 here is the estimate. The stadium only seats 4,200, lots of standing room. And straight ahead's Freddie Smith. He's inside the 15, and he's got that first down to the 13. He he's hit there first by Scott Ellis, a 6'2" junior linebacker, 213 pounds. So Charlie Southeast taking it right down the field. This drive started from their own 19-yard line.
I really like to watch Freddie Smith run, and on that particular play, he knows where he has to get for that first down. He makes sure he gets there, holds on to the ball real tight. He doesn't want to fumble at this stage of the game, and Freddie Smith is the kind of guy that you like to see run. You like to see him run outside where you can see his speed, but he's a good inside runner as well.
So Southeast for that first and 10. We'll call it the 12-yard line. Pollock straight back. He throws a bullet, almost intercepted by Anthony Campbell, and I'll tell you, that was intended for Reeves. And I'll tell you, Charlie, that's one of those dangerous patterns. If it works, it looks great. That was a timing pattern. He threw it before Reeves even made the break. And if Reeves hadn't got there to at least get a hand on it, Anthony Campbell's still going the other way as we speak.
I was talking to Gary Holbrook, who's a teacher here at Southeast, during halftime, and we were talking about the fact that we thought Southeast probably could throw on Riverview as opposed to running against them. But he was pointing out, as so was I, that the interception is dangerous, and that could end up being your worst enemy here tonight. I'm sure they don't want to turn that ball over again to Riverview.
That was close that time. It'll bring up second down 10. Pollock has a keep. He pitches it late. Here comes Freddie Smith. Touchdown. Freddie Smith, Southeast, will take the lead if there are no flags, and I don't see any. Smith goes 12 yards, and that's his, Charlie, that's remarkable, that's his 12th touchdown of the year.
Well, Eddie Pollock and Freddie Smith, they do this better than anybody that I've seen all year long. They take this ball, watch Pollock, waits for the last second, throws it off, and Freddie Smith knows what to do with it. Great call, great play, and it's just a straight option, and they've done it time and time again. This time it's for 6.
Freddie Smith with 9 touchdowns on the ground, 3 in the air. He's got 12 through 5 games. Here's Kerry Ward with the point after attempt. It's up. It's perfect. With 7:21 to go in our third quarter, Southeast has taken a 14-7 lead after falling behind 7-0. They've shaken off a couple of first half fumbles, having to use a timeout, having some jitters, but they've come back here to take this 14-7 lead with 7:21 to go. And I'll tell you, now I think the pressure goes back on Riverview, Charlie. They've got to get that running game going and hang on to the football. If the Southeast defense can rally now and force them to punt, Southeast is looking mighty good.
Well, Southeast kept the pressure off themselves. You remember early in the first half, Riverview fumbled way down in Southeast territory, and Southeast failed to convert. They were unable to take it in for a touchdown. So as a result, then after 2 other turnovers, they put a real pressure on them in the first half. This time, they've kind of turned that over to Riverview, and really it's on their back right now. But I'll tell you something. Riverview is a good football team, and this is by no means over. Riverview will bounce back and probably get right back in this game.
Ward with a short kickoff fielded on the hop down there by Campbell. He takes it right up the middle, runs over a Seminole, but he's dumped at about the 24, where Riverview will try it once again. Charlie, I think one of the things working against Riverview right now is this Southeast crowd. Of course, there's a lot of folks that made the short trip up from Sarasota, but this is obviously a predominantly Southeast Stadium crowd, and they are letting themselves be heard tonight.
Well, we're on the opposite side of the field from the Riverview crowd, so we can't really hear how much noise they're making, but I can tell you there's an awful lot of noise coming from this side.
First and 10 at the 28-yard line. Bernard Marshall. And that's Sean Bain straight ahead. He gets about 4 or 5. Notice that quick start by Sean Bain as Mike McGreed hits him first. But Charlie, there again, for Sean Bain, they've slowed him down. He's not getting that quick burst and getting into a secondary. Southeast with that quick speed up on the line of scrimmage that John Sprague expressed concern about, and for good reason, prior to the game.
We pointed out early that we think the key to the success of the Southeast defense is those linebackers to contain Sean Bain, and they're doing it pretty well right now.
And there's Bain, and he gets up to about the 35. But now you got to remember, here's a guy who came in averaging 12.4 yards a carry. He's nowhere near that tonight. He's having a decent night. He's over 60 yards rushing, but not those miraculous numbers he's had early in the season.
Well, we've said too, Jim, that neither of these teams has played an opponent as good as what they're playing
right
tonight, so their numbers are going to be down a little bit, I do suspect.
So it'll bring up third down and three for Riverview. Very important third down. Bain straight ahead. He's awfully close to the first down. Reggie Green got a hand on him there, along with Rich Frost. As you look at the Southeast cheerleaders, plenty to cheer about. And let's see how close they are.
I think you held him, and now it's going to be decision time for Coach John Sprague.
Fourth down and less than a yard, and let's see if John Sprague has some riverboat gambler blood. He's inside his own 40-yard line, fourth down and about 2 feet, and he does have some riverboat gambler blood. He's going to go for it, fourth down.
Well, he's got some wild blood, we'll tell you that.
A huge play here, fourth down, less than a yard, and now Bernard Marshall, a little psyched out by that defensive line, says, I think I need a timeout, and I'll tell you, Charlie, I think that was a timeout well spent because Southeast was chomping at the bit there.
I wouldn't be surprised. I know that some of the teams have a play right there, and it's called no play. It's
right.
Only designed to come in and draw the other team offside, so I wouldn't be surprised to see the punter come in, or we may see him go for it on fourth and short, but the no play is designed to get you an offside penalty and pick up the first down.
And, of course, once again, we want to thank some of our sponsors for tonight's game, Subway, Subs Done My Way, Coastal Printing, featuring high-quality commercial printing, color, image setting, and design. You can see the difference. Phone those people at 351-1515 and Mixon Farms, Mixon Fruit, excuse me, Southern Goodness for 50 years. Those folks will be opening up October 25th. Just some of our fine sponsors here on Paragon Cable, Channel 22. And Riverview's thought it over, and John Sprague has not changed his mind. He says, we want a first down on fourth down and 2 feet.
He said that wasn't a no play, it's a go play. And we'll see what...
Straight ahead. Now, I don't know if Abner got it. Darrington Abner went straight ahead.
This referee on this side says he missed it.
He says no. And what a huge stand for Southeast. Reggie Green, there he is at the bottom of that pile, number 76. He's going to go to college and play football wherever he wants to at 6'8", 295. Now, we are going to have a measurement. It looks short from up here, Charlie, but we are going to measure. The crucial play of Southeast with the momentum going their way, if they get the ball here, could be curtains for Riverview, but a lot of football left to go. Let's see what the measurement's all about.
Critical measurement.
Bernard Marshall says they got it, and let's see. They do. I'll tell you what. It didn't look like he had it on the play, Charlie. They got a gracious spot, but talk about dodging the bullet. Riverview dodged a howitzer shell that time.
Well, that's absolutely right. And I tell you, Riverview now is they're having a little bit of trouble moving this ball, and they need to get their offense generating. And they've kind of been real sluggish since they came out of the half. And
right.
So we'll see if that thing improves like it was in the first half.
Staying on the ground with Sean Bain, and the going stays tough. Bain stopped right at the line of scrimmage, hitting in there first Cornelius Hicks. And I'll tell you, Charlie, the Southeast defense is always good year in and year out, but they are inspired tonight, especially here in the second half.
Well, the Southeast, the one thing you don't want to let them do is get fired up on you, because then they punish you. And we've seen them absolutely bruise people. But when you see Simmons and Hicks and Hidgen and Wiseman, and you look at those linebackers, Frost, McGreed, and Robich, I mean, they can literally punish you.
Marshall hangs on to it. He crosses the 40. Rich Frost hits him first. And the Seminoles are not taking any prisoners, doesn't look like, tonight.
Now the safeties in the corners are getting in on the act. And Charlie Brown and Brooker and Dunbar. And you see, he's a little bit, all the defense, just a little bit of all of them are getting in and making some tackles here. And they hit extremely hard.
Well, and Charlie, I think Riverview, obviously a running football team, I think they're going to have to throw the football maybe just as a decoy, because Southeast is bringing 8-9 guys up on that line of scrimmage, and we've got a flag down. And I'll tell you what, your folks at home watching on Paragon Cable and throughout the state of Florida on Sunshine Network, that's procedure against Riverview. If your picture looks a little shaky at times, don't fret. That's just the people on the Southeast side pounding their feet. And it's giving our top cameraman a little bit of trouble up there hanging on to that thing. Hope he doesn't fall down in front of us here, Charlie.
And our voice is shaking here because of it as well. This whole place is shaking.
You can probably hear that pretty well at home when they start stomping at feet and Southeast is on defense. Third down and 13. Sean Bain, the second man through, and he gets a decent game, but well short of a first down. At the 40-yard line, that'll bring up fourth down and about 9, and I don't think John Sprague is that much of a gambler. I think we're going to see a punt here.
Yeah, I believe he'll punt it away, because that's a long way to go for a first down. And this river, Southeast defense has really come through. They've done a tremendous job on this particular drive.
So Riverview, with that number one ranking in the state, on the line here, trailing 14-7. They're number one in 5A, Southeast number two in 4A. And punting it away is Hackett, and that's a beauty. Look out, that's drawing some rain. Taking it back at the 14 is Danny Dunbar. He fumbled one earlier. And he won't fumble this one, but he won't go anywhere either. He'll be dumped right at the 13-yard line. So Southeast with some pretty tough field position back at the 13-yard line. But, Charlie, I really think Riverview needs to at least throw the ball against a heavy pursuing defense like Southeast. Even if they have no confidence in throwing the football, just throw it to shake Southeast up, because they're coming up on that line, and Sean Bain isn't having anywhere to run.
I think they're going to have to throw it. It appears they are anyway, because they're Sean Bain and Abner are being worked to death now. And I really want to give some credit there. And we didn't get the yardage on that kick. But let me tell you, Chris Hackett just made one more super punt. That was major league there. And he's got Southeast kind of backed into a hole here.
Southeast hanging on to that 14-7 lead. We got 2:49 left to go, third quarter. I'm Jim Brockman along with Charlie Wells. Thank you for joining us this evening. Pollock. The long signal count gives it to the lone setback, and that's Mike Blakely, and he gets about four straight ahead. He's met there first by Matt Pryor, a 6 foot 203-pound linebacker. That'll bring up second down and six. As you look at that Southeast offense, and they've rolled up some numbers this year with 36.5 scoring average and 355 yards average on offense. But like you mentioned, Charlie, but both teams are playing the best teams they've played all year, and it's keeping those offensive stats down. We're at 14-7. Pitch goes back to Freddie Smith, and he doesn't have any place to go. He tries to break it outside, gets little or nothing. Tripping him up there first is David Knott, 198-pound defensive end. So third down now and about six for Southeast from their own 17. 1:38 to go in our third quarter. And Charlie, our crowd estimate is at about 8,500, and I think that's about right. We got folks lined up all over here in Bradenton, Florida. Thank you for joining us. We've got a flag down. Delay a game for Southeast, so that makes third down and seven now becomes third down and 12 from deep in their own territory. Bradenton Southeast 14, Sarasota Riverview 7. And a well-played football game. And Charlie, we noticed as we called the game in the first half how quickly that first half went by. When you're watching good football and two teams knocking heads, it seemed like it just flew by.
It went by real fast. It was exciting football, and we've been waiting for this game all year long. And I don't know about you, Jim. I've enjoyed it thoroughly so far.
Certainly have. Plenty of football yet left to go. Pollock, you're going to run a draw play to Freddie Smith. He makes a great move in the backfield, and he brings it up over the 20. And he's going to be short of the first down, but he almost picked it up there on third and 12, Charlie. He got about 10.
That draw play worked real well that time. And, I think that's you might even see Riverview go to something like that kind of strings the play out a little bit, or it's a little bit deceptive or a little bit of delay, anything to get the defense maybe get their timing off a little bit. Riverview has not moved the ball well the last couple times they've had the ball, and so what they want to do is something much like that draw, or maybe something very similar as Southeast punts the ball.
Ward hits a line drive. Campbell takes it on the bounce. He is dangerous across the 45, but he's not going to go too far at the 46, and taking the first shot at him there. Oh, it's McGree. So Campbell, but Riverview gets pretty good field position from their own 46-yard line. Let's see what they come up with offensively. And, Charlie, if they're not going to throw the ball, at least maybe run wide, because Southeast is just jamming those gaps from tackle to tackle.
Well, the way they come out, now I'm looking to see if, I don't see Abner right now, but let's see, it looks like they're lining up different with different, no, Abner is in the game, excuse me. The way they come out here, they look run again, but I wouldn't be surprised to see him change to a pass.
We do have a new quarterback in the game, Charlie. We talked about him earlier, Tim Alexander. He's just a sophomore, and maybe John Sprigg was eavesdropping here because he's known to be more of a passer than Marshall. He carried the ball that time and got a decent gain. But that's the end of our third quarter. Don't go away for this one. It's 14-7 Southeast over Riverview. We'll be right back after these messages.
Welcome back, everyone. Tim Alexander has provided Riverview with a bit of a shot in the arm. He just ran for 20 yards. Then Riverview was penalized for procedure. The ball is at the 34-yard line of Southeast. First down and 15 for the Rams. They're threatening to tie this thing up. Opening moments of the fourth quarter. Abner straight ahead. He's close to the 30-yard line before he's brought down. That'll bring up second down and about 11 now. So Southeast stopped Riverview on their initial possession in the third quarter as we look at Southeast coach Paul Meckley. But Tim Alexander, the sophomore, John Sprague's changing quarterbacks. He sat down Bernard Marshall, brought in Alexander, who had a couple of nice runs, a couple of runs for a total of 35 yards.
He's a 149-pound quarterback receiver, and he's a sophomore.
He's going to try and carry it again. Now he's going to pitch it to Bain, who breaks a tackle deep in the backfield. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, that's the kind of great back Bain is. Now, he still is going to lose a yard, but that instead of a 12-yard loss, that's a 1-yard loss because he breaks a couple of tackles in the backfield.
Well, we pointed out time and time again, and it still holds true, you're not going to be able to tackle that guy. Most times, you're not going to be able to tackle Sean Bain up high. If you don't hit him low, he's going to continue on, and that's exactly what he did there. The defender tries to hit him. He hit him up above the belt. Sean Bain's not going to be stopped that way. He's too good a runner.
And you look at big Reggie Green. He's played both ways all night long. 6'8", 295. Third down, 13 for Alexander and the Rams. He's going to heave one deep. He's got Robert Brown down there. It's incomplete, but we've got a flag down. And that was Anthony Rawls back there, and it looks like it might be interference, Charlie.
Well, Anthony Rawls came up behind the defender there, and anytime you come up behind him and touch him while that ball's in the air, there's a good possibility you're going to be flagged for that. And we're going to get a chance to look at it again here, and you can judge for yourself whether or not it was pass interference or not. But the ball is thrown up, and it's a wobbly pass, and you can see Rawls get in on him maybe too fast.
And I'll tell you what, Charlie, if indeed that was interference, it was a good penalty to take because Brown was right there, and he would have made that catch if Rawls doesn't get in there and cause him some grief. And we'll wait for our official call here from our referee. Still talking it over here a little bit. It is interference. It will be against Southeast. And that should give Riverview a first down. They're talking it over with Big Darrington Abner, the senior fullback.
That pass is, it looked like it might have even been tipped. I don't know if it was just a...
Or just a wobbly pass. Yeah, look at John Sprague.
Just one of those ducks you throw out there or what, but it was a real wobbly pass, and it was up in the air for an awful long time, which contributed to that pass interference call.
And it will be a first down at the 16-yard line for the Rams. So now that Southeast defense really being tested. They're trying to protect that 14-7 lead with 10:52 to go in the fourth quarter. Tim Alexander in at quarterback straight ahead, Darrington Abner, and he's a solid bet for 4 or 5 yards every time, and that's what he got that time. Rich Frost wrapped him up around the ankles. Second down.
Two of the best big backs you'd ever want to look at. These guys, they complement each other so well. Abner blocks when Bain carries the ball, and of course, when Bain rolls out on that sweep, Big Abner's right out there in front of him. They really complement one another. They're real good backs. And this Riverview team has an offense that just won't stop.
Second down, 6. And that's Sean Bain. And that's been the key to stopping him all night, Charlie. Reggie Green got a hand on him back in that backfield. They're slowing him up before he gets a chance to start blowing by people. Still got a couple on the play. But they slowed him down. That 12-yard average is taking a beating tonight for Sean Bain against the Southeast defense. Third down and 4 now for Riverview at the 10-yard line of Southeast. They've got to get just
just outside that 5-yard line for a first down.
And they're not thinking field goal here, I don't believe.
Still plenty of time to go in the fourth quarter, but points are coming tough in this game. It's 14-7 Southeast. Southeast fans on their feet, and Alexander's hit for a loss. And they might have to settle for a field goal now. That's Reggie Green got back there first. And he had a bunch of help from some other orange jerseys.
When Reggie Green gets the big paw on you, and then if a split second, if you'll just look around, I want you to watch and count how many orange jerseys are in on this tackle. Watch this. Reggie Green reaches in, gets him. Look at all the orange jerseys. There's about 7, 8, 9. In fact, the entire defense of Southeast is in on that one play. That's good defense there.
And Charlie, we talked about it before the game. I felt that was the key. Southeast with that speed on defense, if they can just get to Bain in the ball before he gets up that head of steam, they've done that fairly well tonight.
We're going again here, Jimmy.
They're going for it. Fourth down and about 7. So John Sprague going for it on fourth down. Here comes Alexander. No way. Forget it. He's stopped on fourth down. Once again, it's Reggie Green. And Reggie Green, already the most sought-after offensive lineman in the United States, according to the Sporting News, might be the most sought-after defensive lineman, too, after tonight. Just a great play. Reggie Green, great quickness, great size. He can write his own football ticket. He's also a good student, well above a 3-point average.
You got to love to watch Reggie Green play. And then he turns right around now, and he comes on offense, and he's a great blocker there. And all of these running backs, you can kind of see a smile on their face when they get to run it over on Reggie's side.
And I'll tell you what, that was a huge play. It was fourth down and 7. Alexander got absolutely nowhere, lost a yard or two, and Southeast holds with a big fourth down, making Riverview turn the ball over. So Southeast, let's see if they just keep it on the ground, try and grind up some of this clock. Plenty to go, over 8 minutes. And that's Blakely. I think he fumbled the ball, but Southeast got back on it, and that's the one thing that could kill Southeast right now. Blakely coughed it up, but I think Jeremiah Joyner jumped on it, one of his linemen there.
I like to watch this Southeast offense, and if you look at across the line there, you got Jeremiah Joyner that weighs 286 pounds, Reggie 289, the center weighs 224 pounds, Omar Edwards. Rodney Hamilton weighs 215 pounds, and David Walker, 249. That's a lot of meat.
That's a lot of folks. Second down and 8 for Southeast. Running out of that eye. Pollock's gone all the way at quarterback, and what a fine job he's done. And there's that pitch to Freddie Smith, but forget it. Riverview saw that coming a mile away, making a stop. Jason Siegel, he's played a lot of both ways tonight, too. And it looks like Freddie Smith's getting a little tired out there, Charlie. He's limped a little bit here since the second half started, and he looks like a tired guy out there.
I think the reason he may be limping there is because Jason Siegel, really bring up his number. And Jason Siegel, we pointed out, is he's the forgotten back, if you will. On offense, he runs back there with Marshall, Abner, and Bain. And you don't get to hear too much about him, but in this particular case, on defense, he put a good hit on Freddie Smith.
So now Southeast faced with a tough third down and 8. They'd love to get a first down here and burn up some clock before they have to turn it back over to the Rams. 6:47 and counting. And there's Freddie Smith getting some decent yardage, but he's going to be short of that first down, I do believe. It's still inside the 20. So Southeast, that's one thing they didn't want to do, was three downs and punt, but now you turn it back over into the solid hands of that Southeast defense. And a classic struggle here. Riverview will get the ball back. Their powerful running game against the powerful defense of Southeast. And once again, we want to mention one of our fine sponsors, Subway. Subs done my way. And all our fine sponsors here at Paragon Cable, we hope you're enjoying the game throughout the state of Florida. Back to punt is Kerry Ward. Back to receive the always dangerous Anthony Campbell. And kind of a high snap. Ward did a nice job with it. Gets off a high, relatively short punt. Campbell's going to let it go, and it takes a bit of a Riverview bounce. So Riverview will get great field position at the 48, and Southeast defense being sorely tested by this powerful Riverview Ram offense. Still plenty of time for the Rams to score in the way they like to score, Charlie. They like to chew up the clock and run, and they've got enough time to do that.
And what Southeast needs to be concerned with here is with 5:51 and counting, is that Riverview can punch this thing in, and the way you call him a riverboat gambler, Coach Sprague, right. He goes for two. They got a chance of winning this
you
thing.
Bet. 5 41. Interesting matchup with Sean Bain straight ahead. McGreed hits him, Simmons hits him, and about any other Southeast defender you want to name. As you look at a concerned Paul Meckley, he's in a real dogfight tonight with John Sprague of the Riverview Rams across the way. And Sean Bain, Riverview just looking to get him some kind of daylight, break a tackle or two, and that young man is gone.
Well, the reason you saw that concerned look on Coach Meckley's face is he knows this game isn't over.
You bet.
And he knows he's got a 7-point lead, but that doesn't mean much right now.
Second down 8 from the 46 of Southeast. Here come the Rams, and it's Sean Bain. He's got a little room. He's at 40, 35, 30. Will he go all the way? Booker's trying to catch him. Forget it. Sean Bain goes 46 yards, just what we were talking about. Sean Bain keeps life interesting for the Riverview Rams. Now we wait for the extra point. Will John Sprague just go ahead and tie it up? He's got one of the best kickers in the area. Gamble a little bit, go for two. There's 4:56 to go in the fourth quarter.
Well, you just never know. I think the kicker Hackett's in there. So if you want to see a real running back, watch Sean Bain right here. I mean, look at him. He just turns on the afterburners, and this is why every time he touches the football, on the average, he has more than a first down, enough yardage for a first down every time he touches it.
It's remarkable. Hackett will kick it, and it's good. And, folks, we are all tied up at 14 apiece with 4:56 to go in our fourth quarter. And Charlie, does overtime ring a bell here tonight?
Well, this is without a doubt one of the best football games I have ever seen, and I'm telling you something, I am really enjoying it. We knew that we had two quality teams coming into this game tonight. We thought they may be pretty evenly matched, and the only thing that maybe that particular letdown on defense, but we've seen some great defensive play by Southeast. We knew that Riverview had a spectacular offense, and they've shown that, and we knew what Sean Bain was all about. But this there's still 4:56 to go. Anything can happen. I mean, we may be tied. It may be overtime, or these turnovers we had, we just don't know.
And, of course, it's interesting, Southeast and Riverview in their matchup. Riverview has not beaten Southeast since 1984. It's a traditional rivalry here, Manatee County's and Sarasota County Schools. They won 28-14 that year, did the Riverview Rams. And the other five times Southeast has played Riverview with Paul Meckley as coach, Riverview has never scored more than 14 points. And we're all tied at 14 right now. So some kind of history is going to be made here tonight one way or the other. Smith deep in yard deep in the end zone. He'll bring it out to the 10, 15. Here comes Freddie Smith. Breaks a lot of tackles, a lot of work to get back just to about the 20-yard line. So Southeast up against it. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, whoever wins this game, I think you're going to have to stay aggressive. You can't play close to the vest. Brian Reed is limping and coming off the field. For a copy of tonight's game, you can call Paragon Cable at 813-748-3816, Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Do that during business hours, and that's serious. Brian Reed, hopefully it's just a cramp. They're fine wide receiver, because Southeast might need to throw the football here to try and take this lead with 4:32 to go in our fourth quarter.
I thought they got a little conservative down here early. You may see them open it up with 4 minutes to go.
I think you got to stay aggressive one way or the other to win this football game. Both teams are just too good to sit on it. Straight ahead. And that's Blakely getting a little yardage out to about the 27. He's wrapped up by Brian Gillen. A nice gain of about 7. We'll call it second down and 3 now for the Seminoles. Just over 4 minutes to go. Sean Bain scored in a hurry, and as well as Southeast has battled him up, Charlie, he's still over 100 yards for the night, pushing the 120 mark. So
you got to feel successful when you hold him to that.
Yeah, really, it's remarkable what this young man can do. Averaging nearly 200 yards a game carrying the football, just outrageous. And there's Blakely again. He's short of a first down. We'll bring up about third down and 2. See where they mark it. They've got to get the ball just outside the 30-yard line for a first down.
Since you noticed that a while ago, Jim, I've been keeping my eye on Freddie Smith, and he is walking awfully slow, and I'm wondering why. I'm wondering maybe if that isn't the reason Blakely's getting the call here two times in a row, is try to give him a little rest. I know what they'd like to do is to play ball control, get this thing down here, take it in for a touchdown with very little time left on the clock if they possibly can, or kick a field goal and not let Riverview get that ball again. But if Freddie Smith, if he isn't up to 100%, that's got to hurt that Southeast offense.
And we see Reggie Green needs a new chin strap. And you got to wonder if this play, Reggie's getting that equipment taken care of. He's being substituted for with Jason Durant. And and they better find him a chin strap in a hurry. They need him on the football field, third down and one.
Critical time to take Reggie out, right. Third and one, too.
They're trying to find a new chin strap for him. 3:15 and counting to go fourth quarter. We're all tied at 14-14. Straight ahead. Oh, keeping it. Ball. He's across the 40, 45, 50. He's got a first down and a bunch more to the 44-yard line. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, Edward Pollock is a guy who gets kind of ignored with all the big guns Southeast has, and he's been hurt some this year. He has played absolutely steady, fine football tonight. Huge play there.
Coach Taylor, he tells me that Pollock just has the opportunity to keep the ball like he does here if he wants to. It's strictly his call. He reads that defense, and if he wants to pitch off, he pitches off, and if he wants to keep it and run, it's strictly his call, and he did a fantastic job with it on that particular play.
He picked up 26 big yards for Southeast. 3:05 to go, fourth quarter. We're tied at 14-14. I'm Jim Brockman along with Charlie Wells. There's Pollock again, and it's a quick five inside the 40 before he's drilled by Anthony Jones, number 22. So the senior quarterback taking charge here with Freddie Smith a little banged up. You don't know if that's an injury with Freddie or if he's just flat out tired. And Reggie Green's back in there. He's got his equipment problems taken care of. But this thing going right down to the wire. Everything we thought would be plus a little bit more. 2:39 to go, fourth quarter. Southeast threatening. They're inside the Riverview 40. Pollock looks like he's maybe changing a play. Audibleizing there at the line of scrimmage. He better hurry up. He's going to throw it. He's got a man deep. He overthrows Kelvin Reese. Almost picked off. And he audibleized into that play. And luckily for Ed Pollock, that play fell incomplete, or he'd had some explaining to do if Anthony Campbell picks that thing off.
Well, once again, you know, Pollock being a senior, the coaches have allowed him to check off at that line of scrimmage whenever he feels it's necessary. And that time it was almost costly because Kelvin Reeves was way out about 8 to 10 yards further than that pass fell. So that was a very, very dangerous play there, and they're lucky they didn't get it picked off.
So now faced with third down and five is Southeast.
And Anthony Campbell over there to pick it off for you. Ooh. That's a dangerous guy to get his hands on the ball, too.
He was a step away. Third down, Southeast Seminoles inside the 40, 2:20 to go. Fakes the handoff, Freddie Smith, Pollock rolls. He's got a man open, can't come up with it. Brown is covering number 81 down there, Luther McFarland, a junior tight end. So now you're faced with fourth down, about 5 yards to go. And let's see if Southeast, what they elect to do here. Looks like maybe they're sending the punt team on.
I think
fourth and five.
I think they have to punt, Jim.
With 2:20.
You give that ball to Riverview right here, and
right.
They are, that's good field position for them.
And I'll tell you what, we're getting closer to what looks like going to be overtime unless Riverview can pull off a big play here in the next couple of minutes. 2:14 to go.
Let's keep our eye on it.
Oh, there's a fake. And Blakely, I think he might have it. They faked the punt, and Blakely grabbed it. A beautiful-looking fake. Ward backed up, looking like he was waiting for that punt. Let's see where they mark it. He's got it. Look at Brian Reed jumping up and down. And Charlie, what really helped make that work, Kerry Ward went running back like the snap went over his head, and Riverview kind of froze on the defensive line, and Blakely just picked up the first down. Fake punts. We've had a little bit of everything tonight.
That thing was stolen right out of the Bobby Bowden playbook.
Yeah.
That's the reason they call this team the Seminoles. They're copying something from FSU here.
I hope Bobby's watching up in Tallahassee. That would make him smile a little bit.
Well, we got a measure, so we're not.
Oh, wait a second. Yeah, we might have. Boy, it looked like he had enough. Blakely got tripped up as he crossed the 35. We wait for the measurement. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's a first down for Southeast at the 33-yard line. The Seminoles starting to celebrate, but it's too early. There's 2:09 left to go, and they need some more points. We're all tied at 14.
Oh, no.
We want to thank you for joining us tonight. You made a good choice here on Paragon Cable Channel 22 and throughout the state on the Sunshine Network. I'm Jim Brockman along with Charlie Wells, and Southeast and Riverview, Bradenton Southeast, Sarasota Riverview, have put on quite a show. We're tied at 14 apiece, just approaching the two-minute mark. First down Southeast at the Riverview 33. Pollock He's going back to the air. He's rolling left. He's running out of real estate. He gets a pass off incomplete. Double covered over there. Campbell drives the receiver Reed out of bounds. Second down, 10.
Well, I think that time, you know, Pollock's running to his left. It's tough to throw that pass that way, and he gets into trouble. And I think he just kind of chunks it away. But, you know, if Southeast goes on to win this game, we'll be talking about that fake punt, and they'll be writing about that for a long time. That was a gutsy call on behalf of the Southeast coaching staff.
And it worked with about 6 inches to spare. Southeast has called a timeout now with 1:50 to go in our fourth quarter. Here on Paragon Cable next week for you, we'll have Tampa Plant at Bayshore. Bradenton Bayshore will have that game for you next week. Following that week, we'll have Manatee Winter Haven. Good to see Manatee again. We haven't seen them in a few weeks. They've come back since they lost to Riverview in the first game of the year that knocked them out of the number one ranking in the nation, plus the state. And, Charlie, here's something interesting. Of course, we don't know what's going to happen here, but if Southeast were to win, Riverview's number one in 5A. If the number two team, Southeast in 4A, beats the number one team in 5A, you've got Manatee number two in 5A, but yet Riverview beat Manatee. It's going to be a tough call for who's number one if Southeast can come through and win this thing.
Well, it really
won't be an easy vote.
It's a vicious cycle we've got ourselves involved in here, but a very interesting one. And, well, I guess everybody wishes that they had this kind of football in their area like we have here in Sarasota and Manatee County.
Right.
We have some of the greatest football, and we know that out in the Panhandle, they have some good football, but we have some right here, too.
Hope some folks are watching throughout the state to see what we got over here on the west coast of Florida. Second down, 10. Pollock, he's back to throw. He's got heat, and he's going to be sacked. A good defensive play there, hitting him first for Sarasota Riverview, Mike Hassab. We've been calling his name a lot tonight on defense. So now Southeast looking at a tough third down and 15 situation. And we'll take a look at the replay. You see, Pollock just has nowhere to go.
Yeah, Pollock, I think that time he looks out and both of his receivers, his wideouts, are covered extremely well, and he just eats it. And I think that may be a wise thing. I know they didn't want to lose the yardage, but I believe it was a wise thing.
So 1-12 and counting. 14-14, Southeast trying to break this tie and win this football game. Here comes the screen, Buddy Smith, but smelling it out perfectly is Guy. And a huge loss on the play. Now we're looking at fourth and about 29. And I'll tell you what, Charlie, barring a punt return or something for a touchdown, I think we're going to go to overtime. It'll be our first one of the year.
Well, I think we will look at our first overtime. Look at this play. You see Pollock goes out. He throws the ball out to Freddie Smith, and Freddie doesn't really even get a chance to tuck it in good, and he's dumped out there real well. Great defense on that particular play. They smelled it out. But, you know, that was the play a while ago, that same play that Freddie Smith scored on. So he floats out there as a safety valve, and this time he does not fool the defense.
Well, you see this story on the scoreboard, 14-14, 47 seconds left. And, of course, last fourth down for Southeast, they faked it and picked it up on a punt. But now you're looking at fourth down and 21, and that's a whole other story. Paul Meckley out there talking with the Seminoles. Beautiful night here in Bradenton. Beautiful balmy night, about 68 degrees. Humidity levels are down, middle of October. Beautiful night for football and two great teams punching it out here.
I don't think Coach Meckley was talking about any trick plays here. I believe what he was talking to them about is to punt that ball and to play good defense once that ball has changed hands. In other words, don't let Anthony Campbell get his hands on that thing and run a, you know, 90-95-yard touchdown play here. I think that's what he was telling me.
Kerry Ward had the great fake on that fake punt. Kicks this one. That's a nice-looking high punt, just what Paul Meckley ordered. And it'll die inside about the five. Perfect coffin corner punt. So Riverview, if they want to score in the last 35 seconds, Charlie, they've got to go about 96 yards to do that, or else we're going into overtime.
They brought Kerry Ward in here off the basketball team, and this is all he does is kicks. And they let him punt, and they let him kick points after, and maybe field goals, but nothing else. And he does this extremely well, and he backs Riverview up. And with the 35 seconds to go, I believe you're right. I think we're going to look at our first overtime unless something spectacular happens here.
So Riverview, and let's see, officials are calling a timeout as Southeast has spent a timeout. They want to make sure they're all on the same page here. Actually, the ball spotted on the 4-yard line, so they're 96 yards away. Fausto Laser, you see the defensive coordinator running out there to chat a little bit. They just don't want to do anything stupid or let Mr. Sean Bain get a hold of something. He can go a ways if you don't bottle him up right now.
And I think Riverview is real conscious of not doing anything stupid down here as well. They don't want to turn the ball over. They don't want to fumble it. I don't believe you'll see them throw from down there. I think you'll just see Sean Bain carry the ball just like he's been doing all night. Maybe Abner. And I've wondered all many times tonight how come they haven't called on Jason Siegel. He's a good runner as well. You might see his number just for a little deception down there.
So it's lived up to its billing, this game. Number one ranked in 5A Riverview against number two ranked in 4A Bradenton Southeast. And we've had quite a football game. And it's not over yet. We got 29 seconds to go. We're all tied up. And barring something unforeseen, we're going to play on into overtime. But Riverview still has a couple of shots. Let's see what they try and do. Alexander's in at quarterback, the sophomore, going straight ahead to Darrington Abner. And you wonder if they'll just let her go from here. With that kind of a play on first down, doesn't look like they're going to try and do anything out of the ordinary. But Riverview is going to take a timeout. It's booked too soon. 17 seconds to go. 14-14. Abner got about 5 on the play.
Well, Abner is a good-looking running back. You know, a fullback's got a tough job. He's up there. He doesn't have anybody in front of him to block, or had that extra man up in front of him to block like a tailback does. And he's a great big fullback, and he runs the ball extremely well, and he stretches out real well and runs over people. He's just a good-looking back. And another thing he does, he's an unselfish player. Like we pointed out earlier, when Bain gets that ball, Abner's right there to block for him, and he's one of his greatest fans when he's carrying the ball. So they complement each other extremely well, and he's just a good-looking backfield for Riverview.
And what an interesting matchup. John Sprague, the Riverview coach, before the game was talking about how he considers his offensive line to be perhaps the most valuable part of his team. And against that Southeast quick defense, what a fabulous matchup that's been, that Riverview offensive line and that Southeast defense. Just been an excellent matchup, and we're all tied. 14-14, 17 seconds to go. Riverview with time for another play or two. And if nobody scores in the next 17 seconds, we're going to play some more. Rolling left is Alexander. He gets outside, and he'll cross the 15, 20, 25, near the 30 before making a saving tackle down there, number 21, that Jerry Nelson on the stop. And let's see if Riverview, the clock will stop momentarily for the first down. 8 seconds remain.
Well, you talked about it a while ago. You see Alexander gets this ball here, and he just kind of tucks it and comes back across the grain and breaks a couple of tackles. And this guy is extremely quick, and you really got to keep your eye on him when he's carrying the ball, because he darn near broke that, and that could have been a real turnabout in this game.
And Riverview just downed it. Alexander downed it. They're saying, let's go to overtime, and we will. Don't go away. We're all tied. 14-14. Bradenton Southeast, Sarasota, Riverview from Bradenton. Don't go away. We'll be back to the overtime after these messages. In the field for our coin toss, and no, this isn't the beginning of the game. We did this a few hours ago, but it's overtime. We're all tied at 14 apiece between Riverview and Southeast. We'll see what our coin toss is, and we'll explain this Kansas tiebreaker rule, the way we settle ties here in the state of Florida in high school football. And it looks like Riverview has won that toss, Charlie. And it's kind of interesting whether you choose the ball first or not. Because what you get, it turns into almost like a baseball game when you get your last at bat. One team will start on the other team's 10-yard line. You get 4 tries to go 10 yards to try and score, get a field goal, whatever you can. Then the other team gets their shot from the other team's 10-yard line. And if you've seen some of these games with us here on Paragon before, I remember a game we had with Manatee Lakeland about 3 years ago where we went about 4 or 5 overtimes before Manatee finally pulled it out. That turned out to be a key district game, and Manatee went on into the playoffs. But that's what we'll do. We don't. The clock means absolutely nothing right now. The clock is off. We're in overtime, and it looks like Riverview will will take their first shot at the 10-yard line of Southeast, trying to score. Regardless of what Riverview does, Southeast will get their licks back down at the Riverview 10-yard line, and their four tries to try and score. It's called the Kansas tiebreaker, and it eliminates the ties. There is no time limit on this. It's not like in the NFL where you have a fifth quarter, and if nobody scores, that's it. We'll play till somebody gets more points and wins this one.
You know, Jim, I believe that Riverview, unless I missed something here, I believe Riverview ran this toss but opted to let Southeast have the ball first. And I don't,
right.
And it may be a strategy that they're using here, because you really put a lot of pressure on the team if you score first.
Right.
You put a lot of pressure on the other team, but if you fail to score, then your defense really has a lot of pressure on you,
right.
So maybe that's a strategy here.
Well, you know, it's interesting, too, Charlie. When I first moved down to Florida, one of the first games I covered for Paragon Cable was a tiebreaker with Bradenton Manatee and Sarasota Riverview. We'll get back to that in a minute. Southeast with their first try at the 10-yard line. We're in overtime. Pollock with it, pitch back to Freddie Smith. He's inside the 10, the 5. Freddie Smith will score. So Southeast, that's what you want to do. So Freddie Smith with his 13th touchdown of the 5-game season thus far. Smith goes 10 yards. So the strategy by John Sprague against Southeast, the ball first, has backfired, at least up until this point.
And a big point after coming right here.
A huge point after.
This is imperative that you make this, because you really throw that pressure back on your defense again. And so they need to make their point after so that they can apply the pressure to Riverview.
Danny Dunbar is the holder. Kerry Ward will attempt the all-important extra. High snap, gets it down. Ward kicks it, and it's good. So Southeast will take a 21-14 lead, and Riverview, in essence, with their last at bat, we'll keep it right here. Now Riverview will stay at this end of the field, and they'll try and go 10 yards. But Charlie, what I started to say was Riverview, when I first started calling games for Paragon, they had that Kansas tiebreaker, which Manatee won. It was a three-way deal. It was crazy with Manatee, Sarasota, Riverview. Manatee won that thing for the district. Here comes Freddie Smith. Yeah. Look at him break a tackle.
Well, Freddie Smith is very determined here, Jim. He means he's going to punch this thing in the end zone and say, hey, look here. We're going to put the pressure on Riverview. But now,
gotcha.
I think what you're going to see here, and I don't think Riverview is going to do anything foolish or change anything. They're coming into this thing with Darrington Abner, and they're going to come in here with Sean Bain. You're going to see one of the two carrying the ball, I do believe.
So here comes the four-down try for Riverview. They trail 21-14. We're in overtime. And Alexander Willis, right, he's got some room. He's inside the 10, but recovering out there. Nate Simmons drills him, and he's going to get called for the flag. That's a tough call at that point. He had him out of bounds at the 8. A little tough on the tackle, drives him out of bounds, and it's going to cost him half the distance.
Well, that's right. I no longer get the words out of my mouth about Abner and Bain carrying the ball. Who carries it? Alexander.
Right.
And they throw him out of bounds over there, and they rough him up a little bit, and so they're going to get a penalty. And you're saying half the distance, I believe, is where they're going to spot the ball. And that certainly gives Riverview a real big chance, and they had him stopped on the 8.
But now they'll have it down to about the 4. And as we mentioned, the bottom line to that story is Manatee went on to win that tiebreaker and went on to win the state Class 5A championship that year in 1985 over Pensacola Wooden. So the Kansas tiebreaker figures heavily into high school football. And that's straight ahead. Abner crawling. He's short. He's down to about the 2. McGreed hits him there along with Cornelius Hicks. And now you're looking at the 2-yard line now. And, of course,
well, I think that roughing call gave him an automatic first down.
Yeah.
And that was a critical mistake.
Right. And you can't really fault Simmons. I mean, it wasn't really a cheap shot. He just drilled him hard, but he happened to be a yard out of bounds. I don't think there was anything cheap about it, just aggressive play. But now they change it to 3rd and 2, so we'll see. Straight ahead, Abner. No signal yet.
No signal.
So now it's 4th down, and about a yard. It could come to this if Riverview punches it in. We'll probably go to another overtime. If they don't, it's all over. Southeast wins. It's that simple. 4th and 1. Nice, simple Kansas tiebreaker. There's big Reggie Green. They're going to have to move him out of there to get that thing tied up. We've got a timeout on the field.
Yeah, Coach Sprague looks like he's out there talking to the official.
He needs to talk to his team right now. Forget the official. At this point, you can't be worrying about the official. You need to get 6. So it's come down to this, 21-14. We're in overtime. The clock is no factor now. We, in essence, play innings, and everyone gets their shot. And this is Riverview's last shot to tie this thing up. Southeast came out right away in overtime. Freddie Smith skirted left end for 10 yards and a touchdown. Ward hit the extra point to put the pressure on Riverview, and they're looking at fourth down now in less than a yard. If they score a touchdown here and get the extra point, we're going to play another overtime. We'll flip the coin once again in the whole bit. And the south, there's no one on the southeast side of the stadium sitting, and from what I can tell across the way, everyone from Riverview's on their feet too. It's come down to this, fourth down and one. Alexander hands it off. Adnan, he's in. No problem, Darrington Radner on fourth down. A little bit of drama here tonight at Southeast Stadium in Bradenton. So now, still, we wait for the extra point. And John Sprague bragging about his kicker before the game, and well, he should. Chris Hackett, he's a good one.
Well, keep an eye on
it. Or you can go for two. You can go for two and try and win it here if you're in that gambling mood. Let's see what we got.
Well, that's exactly right. You can go for two and try to put this
thing right
away. And, you know, I don't see the kicker in there.
Wow, I'll tell you what, this is really gambling because you either win it or lose it on this play. And Southeast has called a timeout. And this is wild. You suppose on the road, John Sprague's saying, let's just try and get two. And if he makes it, they win. If they don't, Southeast wins. So coming down, it could be coming down to this last play. You see where the ball is there on the three-yard line. Fausto Laser, if he ever had words of wisdom for his defense, it's time to pull him out now. And the Rams behind Tim Alexander, they've come back here with Alexander replaced Bernard Marshall early in the second half, and we haven't seen any more Marshall. He was limping a little in the first half, but I don't know if it was enough to get him out of the game. Alexander provided a little spark here running the football.
And Chris Hackett's still on the Riverview sideline, and he's their kicker, so I have to assume that Riverview's going to try to win it right here with the two-point conversion.
Very interesting, just like a last at bat. It's if the kicker does not come on the field, you either score 2 points and win, or you don't get 2 points and you lose. It's 21-20 right now. Southeast on top. Riverview is going to go for two.
Here's the whole game.
This is
just one play.
It's absolutely this last play, unless there's a flag and we do it again. From 3 yards out, it's come down to this in overtime here in Bradenton. And now Alexander, maybe with some cold feet down there, says, I better have timeout. And I don't blame him. And if Riverview keeps to this philosophy and they don't bring Hackett on the field, this will be the last play of the game.
Well, Hackett's still standing over
there.
He's
still over there.
In fact, he's kneeling now, and his knees are starting to get a little wobbly.
he's not loosening up. In case they change their mind, he might want to be stretching over there a little bit. There it is, 21-20. We got no time. We're in overtime. The ball's on the 3 yard line. Abner just punched it in from a yard out on fourth down here in overtime to make it 21-20 as we wait for our extra point attempt. And so far, at least prior to this timeout, Riverview had elected to go for 2 points to either win it or lose it on this play. If they gain 3 yards and score, they win. If they don't get 3 yards and score, they lose it 21-20.
I'd love to be in those huddles listening to Fausto Laser and Coach Sprague. I mean, I'd give $100 to be in either one of those huddles listening to what's going on.
Here it is. I mean, we're coming down left. John Sprague is saying, I don't want this. We played long enough. We're going to win or lose it right here. Tim Alexander. Pitch goes back to Sean Bay, and he runs right. And no, he doesn't get in. He's killed. Here at Southeast Stadium in Bradenton. Southeast has upset a mild upset. Southeast is now 6-1 with Paul Muckley at coach against Riverview. They've won it in overtime, 21-20. Charlie, some thoughts on this wild football game?
Well, a real gamble by Coach Sprague, and he goes for two. He probably could have kicked the point after and tied this thing up and go at it again, but hey, that's his call, and he's a real gamesman. I admire him for trying to win the ball game, and
I'm sure that now, after it's happened, he'd like to have it back. But what the heck? He's got a great football team. Riverview is a good football team, and I think everybody has seen that. And I'll tell you something, Southeast got their money's worth here tonight by playing a team. They've won it, and congratulations to them.
I'll tell you what. So number two in Class 4A Southeast has beaten number one in Class 5A Sarasota Riverview here in Bradenton. So the Seminoles remain undefeated. They go 5-0. Riverview falls to 4-1 in an absolutely wonderful football game. We hope you enjoyed it at home. The winning difference, Freddie Smith scores on his overtime 10-yard run. Kerry Ward adds the extra point. Riverview comes back to make it 21-20 when Abner goes over from 1 yard out. They forget using their excellent kicker, Chris Hackett, and instead of going for a relatively sure tie to keep overtime going, that John Sprague, the coach of Riverview, gambles. He runs his best runner to the right. He gets drilled out of bounds by that Southeast secondary, and that's it. We've ended it here at 21-20 in a fabulous football game. We hope you've enjoyed it here at Paragon Cable in Manatee County and throughout the state on the Sunshine Network. Once again, our final score, Southeast 21, Riverview 20. I'm Jim Brockman for Charlie Wells. Have a very pleasant, good evening.